In a world bent on destroying the family, how do you defend the family and lead the next generation? Join us this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana, for the Summit for Survivors. Arm yourself for success with clear thinking, the science from the experts, and the stories of the survivors. Visit summitforsurvivors.org for more details.
In this episode of the Ruth Institute Podcast, Dr. Jennifer Morse speaks with Father Rob Jack on driving home the faith. They discuss what a post-Roe world is going to look like. Short answer, it won't be pretty at first and may be a rough ride for our country, but if we learned anything from Prop 8 in California, then this will be the time to not make any withdrawals from action or pressure. No retreats after Roe defeat. Dr. Morse comments on how in California the sexual revolutionaries bought district attorneys, elected law enforcement officials, and other political figures to sue, fight, and prosecute all opposition to same-sex marriage after the voters passed Prop 8. Dr. Morse hypothesizes that the same will occur again nationwide very soon. Dr. Morse also explains the birthright of every child is to be loved by both parents in a stable marriage, a forgotten truth. She indicates that family breakdown is always somewhere in the background of school shootings, violent acts, rioters, etc. Dr. Morse also points out that the sexual revolution is like a hurricane which has devastated each facet of our culture so much that even good families are struggling to protect their children. Please continue listening to hear for yourself.
With us now is Dr. Jennifer Robat Morse, and she holds heads the Ruth Institute, which is an interfaith nonprofit organization helping defend the family and repair the damage of the sexual revolution. Dr. Morse, thanks for being with us.
Oh, thanks so much for having me. You know, we just got word this week that Tan Books is going to be one of our sponsors at our Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution, and we'll be giving away copies of that book for the people who are emerging leaders and some of our speakers and people like that. So we're very excited that Tan is supporting what we're doing.
And isn't Tan also publishing a new book from Carrie Gress about the whole history of gender, genesis of gender, which is also something that will definitely be helpful?
Oh, I wouldn't be a bit surprised. They have published other things of hers. If I'm not mistaken, they were her publisher for one of her books on anti-Mary or feminism or something.
Oh, yeah.
So I wouldn't be a bit surprised. I wouldn't be a bit surprised if they aren't doing that.
Oh, I thought that I was trying to give you a free plug because I thought, because, you know, that book definitely fits in with the topic you're dealing with. I was reading an article from Crisis today from, I think it's Eric Sammons, who's the editor, and he says he thinks...
Yes.
He says the article has the sexual revolution overplayed its hand, because
The
more prominent, shall we say, progressives who are atheists are even calling the trans movement on the carpet.
Yes, I saw that article too, and you know, I appreciate what he had to say, but I'm gonna push back against it a little bit and say, you know, how many times have we thought they've overplayed their hands?
Yeah.
Okay. They have never overplayed their hands until we force them back. We have got to. We can't assume that anything will happen automatically. Other than that, I liked his article a lot, but I just want to make sure everybody understands. I believe they won't just fall over and go away on their own steam.
Oh, dear Lord, no. I mean, it's clear. it's clear, especially with what we're dealing with right now, you know, the whole Pride Month thing and everybody coming out in full flower. And unfortunately, you know, when I was in the seminary in the 80s, the homosexual environment was just, that was just the environment, and you had to live it, and you had to find the heterosexual ghetto to kind of live in at the time. It was so bad.
Yeah.
And one of these people who I was in school with from another diocese, he since left the seminary before he could be ordained. He started his own kind of religion thing. He's a very talented musician, but he's declaring war on all the people who don't accept that all that he is his right, that somehow if religion or a government denies his right, he wants nothing to do with it. And I'm sitting there thinking, who's trying to take away your rights here, Sparky, you know?
It's almost like John Lennon and Imagine.
It really is.
Imagine.
It really
what
is.
It's so banal.
I'll tell you, it hit and all the companies right now, all these corporations, they are pandering.
Yeah.
I was reading an article about, I guess, NASCAR was upset. They're kind of repentant because of they tried to be inclusive. I hate that word, and all that kind of stuff. And in the process, they feel like the governor of Texas has squelched their ability as NASCAR to be more inclusive. I don't get it, doctor. But you know, this is how this is the game when we're playing, and you know the. Our topic today is, of course, what a post-Roe world is going to look like. And I'm going to tell you, I don't think it's going to be a pretty one for a while.
Oh, there's no question that it's going to be. We're in for a rough time. We need to celebrate, assuming the court does what we think they're going to do. And I think what they're going to do is announce it the last Friday of June at the end of the term, which is when they customarily have always made their big announcements, right? They're not going to let this leak push them around. They're going to do what they would normally do. So that's what I'm assuming that's what's going to happen. It corresponds with the same weekend that the gay marriage decision was handed down seven years ago, you know, and all that's happening around the same time as our conference. But anyway, wait a minute. Where are we going with this?
I'm sorry to give you a whiplash, but my point with this is that we see, you know, with what's going on now, a post-Roe world, people think it's going to be idyllic, and it's not going to be idyllic.
Right.
If nothing else, the stakes are going to be raised, and my fear, and I speak as a Catholic priest, you know, whose radio station here is right next to the chancery of an archdiocese, and I'm expecting the picketers and the protesters not to take this lightly, because we know the other side is very much a sore loser.
Yeah, I think that's right. So I think it's important that we do celebrate where we can, but understand they're going to try to take it away. Of course, they're going to fight tooth and nail. That's because that's what they do, and they don't play fair. I remember distinctly, Father, after we won Proposition 8, when the election was over and the people of California voted for man-woman marriage, everybody was so surprised. And I remember we celebrated that day and that night, but very quickly, within 24 hours, there was a mob surrounding the Mormon temple in Los Angeles, and the police doing nothing about it, you know. And very quickly, it became clear that they were going to be filing lawsuits, and there were going to be all these legal challenges that we didn't anticipate. And so I think it's important that we understand we're in for a rough ride, but this is a significant victory, and we need to take full advantage of it, you know. Yeah, I think you probably will see protesters and all the rest of it. I think that's probably what's going to happen. These people are going to come unhinged. 2020 was the summer of 2020 was, what do we want to call it? Civil unrest took place across the country.
Yeah, with the George Floyd and all the other places. Oh, yeah.
That's right. So, I think it would be foolish to ignore the possibility that something like that is going to happen this summer as well.
And the thing is I don't believe, as you said, Doctor, law enforcement is going to be that helpful.
Depends on the place, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, one of the
in Cincinnati, I don't think we're going to have that problem, but places like Los Angeles and Detroit and New York City.
And you know what they've done? What the bad guys have done is they've basically gone and invested a lot of money in elections of district attorneys and elected law enforcement positions. You know, who's responsible for saying we're going to press charges against this guy? You know, there are a lot of those people who were elected with money provided by George Soros. Okay, and those are the catch and release guys. You know, so in those cities, who knows what might happen? But the fact is, the post-Roe world is something that we've been preparing for. When you think about the network of crisis pregnancy centers across this country, those women are ready for action. You know, they are ready to serve. They are ready to help people who are in crisis. And we at the Ruth Institute, we're ready to serve too. We're ready to serve in the sense of helping people understand how central abortion has become to our society and how we walk some of that back, you know, and put back together the pieces of people supporting one another in living a life that is sustainable. The hookup culture lifestyle is really not sustainable. It doesn't really make people happy. This is the thing, you know. And so there are going to be people who are going to be rethinking their primary commitments, just like the whole transgender thing has made people, has shocked people into rethinking their commitments. You know, what do I really believe about these things, you know? And so it's important that we conduct ourselves with grace and with some class, and that we not lose our minds, and that we not lose our tempers and so on. You know, that's very important.
Well, the advantage that the pro-abortion group has had and the whole sexual revolution people have had is that they were always playing the long game. And they've been evolving this for decades. And now that chicken is coming home to roost, and we're going to have a little bit of a pushback. But the thing I see happening is that we see it happening on so many levels. Okay, we're against, you know, definitely we want to, you know, protect all unborn children. And yet the thing is when now they don't have that, they're going to start begetting violence with violence. But what they don't realize is they're wringing their hands now. The violence against children is going on with, you know, people who are mentally ill because of the culture in which they were brought up and the dysfunction that's going on. And we're seeing killings in grocery stores, in schools, in a hospital. Doctor, can you address kind of how all of this stuff really does fit together?
Sure. Let's try. When you think about the family and the centrality of the family, the love of the mother and father for each other is supposed to bring a child into life. You know, a human person is meant to be loved into existence. And your mom and dad, their relationship is the foundation of your life, for good or for ill. If they don't have a relationship or they have a bad relationship, that's a big thing in your life, you know. And if you have if you have pervasive family breakdown the way we have, or families never forming at all, the kids are not getting what they need. Honestly, it's the birthright of every person to know their parents and to be loved by their parents and to be in relationship with their parents. And we've treated that like it's nothing. This is the throwaway culture Pope Francis talks about, right? You know, that you can cash out your relationships and nothing bad will happen, because we must have our sexual liberty, and I want a new partner, so I'm going to leave my old partner, and who cares what wreckage I leave behind me. You know, we got to stop that. It's very, very damaging to children. And now we've got one generation after another of people growing up without the proper formation, without the proper foundation of love in their lives. Now they're having children. They don't know what to do with their kids, you know. And each generation is coming out with more and more of a burden, you could say, you know, of rejection, of toxicity. And I think that's what we're dealing with. And if you look at a lot of these cases, I don't even want to try to catalog all the cases, but when you look at a lot of these cases of mass killers and active shooter events and these type of things, you know, time and again, what you find is family breakdown is part of the picture.
You know, and with that, it's almost, doctors, if there's a, children are walking in a world today full of landmines, and if they manage to dodge the family landmine, then they get to the point of high school or their education where again, trusted people, namely teachers and other examples in the culture, are telling them that they need to question their very reality as male or female. And there, of course, there's another trap, because if they fall into that, because they're trusting of the people in authority, now all of a sudden they're going to be attacked by drugs, whether it's mind drugs because of all the things that go on with ADHD, or, you know, then we get to the gender drugs of the of hormone things. And, you know, that's another landmine that many are now falling on, good, solid families. And they've been thrown into this mess, and now the children are becoming medical experiments.
Yes. And when you think about it, you said even good families are having this happening to them. And I want your listeners to just think about this image, okay? if you're going through a neighborhood and there's one house that's all falling down and the grass is not cut and nothing's repaired, you look at that house and you go, what the heck's the matter with these people? But if you go through a neighborhood like we have here in Lake Charles, and every single house is falling down, and the trees are falling every place, and there's a, you know, there's branches through the windows, and everything's state of disrepair. You go, what happened here? Well, a hurricane came through. That's what happened here. Okay, and it's nobody's fault. And what has happened to us as a culture, the sexual revolution, is created by human beings. I'm not going to treat it like it's a force of nature, because it's not. It was created by human beings. But the impact it has on people is like a hurricane.
Yes.
And it affects everybody. It affects everybody. Even good families are struggling to protect their children from the culture. This is that's why when you see our things that you and I talk on the radio, but I mail things to you, you know. And so you see, we always refer to the sexual revolution with capital letters.
Yes.
So it's a thing like the French Revolution, like the Bolshevik Revolution. It's a thing. It is just as destructive as those things.
If not more, because it reaches to the core. We've been talking today with Dr. Jennifer Roebuck Morse, and of course, 3 weeks from tomorrow starts their big conference. And so, Dr. Morse, if people want to sign up for this conference, where can we send them?
You need to come right away to ruthinstitute.org and click on the summit page. It's right there. And sign yourself up and come on down. Come on down to Louisiana. Best food in America, which you cannot get with a virtual pass. I mean, you can get a virtual pass, but you can't get the food that way.
No deliveries, huh? No. Okay, well, that's good to know. Well, thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Morse. We look forward to talking with you soon.
Thanks very much.
The traditional family is under attack. Are you tired of standing there flat-footed and tongue-tied when your Christian beliefs are under attack? Join me, Dr. Jennifer Roebuck Morse, this June 24th and 25th in Lake Charles, Louisiana, at the Ruth Institute Summit for Survivors of the Sexual Revolution. Join hundreds of other people to get compelling stories, persuasive arguments, and the science to back it all up. Defend your values without fear or apology. Our website is summitforsurvivors.org.